Hello everyone and welcome to the Foreman community demo. We are available on IRC on the Foreman channel in the Freenode and on Twitter. So we have a lot of conferences coming up. Come to see us at our booth at DevConf in Brno in 2 weeks and at FOSDEM in Brussels in 3 weeks along with some Foreman talks in the info room. After that, we will have our usual track and booth at Config Management in Ghent right after FOSDEM, finishing with a hack day, all day of Foreman on the 5th of February. Next up, our community survey is out. Tomer is here and he will give some few words about it. Tomer.
Hello, so the long-time members of the community have probably heard about this before quite a few times. I think this is probably the fourth or fifth year that we are having the community survey. Since Foreman doesn't collect any data about your usage of Foreman, we need a survey to know what you are doing, what you are using it for, what you are happy about, what you aren't happy about, so we can improve and make Foreman a better project for everyone to use. The survey is a bit long, but it shouldn't take more than about 10 minutes to fill out. So any feedback is very useful for us, and we appreciate it. This is a chance for you to impact the direction of the development of the project. Even if you don't know how to contribute or you're not a developer, this is super important and super useful for us. This year, there's also a section where we're asking about several areas of Foreman that we aren't sure if they're really useful, and we are thinking of maybe dropping them or extracting them plugins so we can make Foreman a bit easier to use and install and to maintain. So look out for that section while you're filling out the survey. The feedback will be really useful in telling us where to focus our efforts in the next year. You can find the link to the survey in the website and on our community forums. And thank you for your time.
Thank you, Tomer. And I want to mention every survey that you fill out is going to have a lot of benefit for us. And you don't have to fill everything, just fill whatever you feel that you want. And this will give us some value. So next with our demos, today it's going to be a day full of UI demos, a full day only about UI. So the first one is the Redux middleware. We will talk about the new Foreman test and the new Foreman stories. So next up is Ron Lavi. We'll talk about Redux middleware. To you, Ron.
Hey everyone. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can see it.
Cool. So before I talk about our Redux API middleware, I want to go to the Redux flow. The basic flow is, let's say I have some view. I clicked on something, let's say a button, an action was fired, and it updated the store, which updated again the view. Now, if I zoom in to the store, you can see that from the action, which is just firing a simple object with type and payload, later I will dive into it, it updated a reducer, which decide how to update the store state, which is later updating the view. Now, the middleware is the part between the action and the reducer. It receive action. It can, let's say, it can delete it. It can check its type and decide to manipulate it. Or it can do nothing and just pass the action to the reducer. And you can also dispatch another actions from it. We'll talk about it. As an example, I want to show you a code that recently was updated, the fact charts. Basically, let's say we clicked on the button to view a chart. it should open a model. Now, this is from the Redux DevTools. You can see that when I press that button, the fact chart model open was fired, that action. And you can see that inside this action, there I have only a type, which is a string, and payload, which contains all of the data that I want to transfer to my reducer, which will update the state. Now, if we look on the state diff, we can see that I got some model to display with ID, 39 in this case, and the title of the model. After the state was updated, we can see in the title, I got the exact title that was in the payload, and fact values, which transformed into a chart. I want to talk for a second about our file structure. Let's say I have a component named my component, very original. In that folder, I have the my component JS file, which we prefer to be the most simple file with only React view code or only JSX. Keep it really simple. At the my component actions file, there will be my Redux actions. In the reducer, the Redux reducer. In the selector, it's the place that I select from the store whatever props or arguments to pass to my component. And in the index file, I connect all of the above. Now let's see, let's take a look at, on the action. That open model has two action dispatch inside of it. One of it's the API, which I will show you later the middleware of it. And there is the model open that we just saw. In the index file, you can see I imported it from the action file, and I pass all the arguments that I got, some of them from props passed to the connected fact chart. This is the main component that's connected to everything, and some props that I received from selectors, which we will talk later on. So after that get action was fired, I check in the middleware if the action that I received has the right type. Right now we support the get action. Soon we will add all of them. We just want it to be stable enough. And if it's not, just pass that action to the next middleware. And from there to the reducers. So let's take a look. Here we just split the code to from the middleware to keep it more simple, to split it into another file called API request. This is the API request. And here you can see we manage the whole lifecycle of the request. First, we dispatch here an action that just states that a request is happening. So the consumer can show some loading spinner or to make the component react to it. And later we are making the actual API call. We wait to receive the data, and then we dispatch success action or failure action. From here, as we saw before, from the middleware, it passed to the API reducer, which will update the state as we saw earlier. If you take a look on the right side, you can see that the same fact chart got a response with the name of that component and the values, I guess, for the graph. And you can see the whole process. We had a request, we had the API get, the model opened, and we got the success. Okay, so this is our index file. As I promised you to talk about the selectors, So basically, as you can see, the selectors receive a key. That key is very important for the API request, because both the action, as you can see here below, receives it, and with that key it registered in the store. So later we could select the right state that changed. Let's say we have fact chart, we have autocomplete, we have bookmarks, we have many actions. This is the selector file, and you can see we added here some selector helpers from API selectors. So you can select the response, you select the status. These are will be always the name of those keys in the state, the change. And if you want to select something from the response, let's say values, and in this case, we call it in our component chart data, but in the store, you can see that the API response returned just values. Back to the index file, you can see we called it just char data, and then we pass it into the inner component. One last file, I promise. This is the inner component. You can see it's only HTML and React. It's very basic. It just received the props and acts upon it. You can see here open model, close model. It looks really simple here, but we know that behind the scenes there are actions and they trigger this whole cycle. Thanks.
Thank you, Ron. So one question that I have is, where can I find all this documentation? Let's say I want to use your GET and use the new API in my component. Do you have a documentation link for that?
Right. So basically everyone has the documentation link. You run the storybook, npm run storybook, and there you can see the I think it's the introduction content there, one of the first. You can see everything about the API middleware, and you can see even an example that you can copy paste, or you can take a look on the fact chart, for example, how it works. Yeah.
Thank you, Ron. That was very, very interesting. I guess we are going to see many uses of it across the application now. So next, Amir is going to speak about the Foreman test. To you, Amir.
Hello, everyone. Let me show my screen, just a second. There is a technical issue, just a second. Maybe I just need to exit. Just a second.
Technical issues is the life. You always have them. Take your time, Amir.
Can you see my screen?
Yes. I can see your screen.
So today I'm gonna show you the Foreman test. The Foreman test is part of the Foreman ENV, which we presented on our roadmap. Basically, it's a set of tools for development environment, for plugins, and of course, for Foreman core. So what is that the Foreman test? Basically, it has just configuration opinionated to Foreman with enzyme, and just for knowing that Jest is a common library for testing in JavaScript. We have enzyme. Enzyme is the glue between Jest and React and Redux. And we have test utils for unit and integration test, and unit, of course, for the component testing, and integration means integration between Redux and React. And also we have coverage tool. We use coveralls in this package. Discover your code, how much your code is covered. So why we need that package? We believe in order to collaborate across plugins and Foreman core, we need opinionated configurations, of course, testing utils, and that can be shared easily across plugins, and of course, may reduce a lot of boilerplate. So the installation process is quite easy. As you can see, you just need to install the package from the Foreman test. Sorry, from NPM, the package called the Foreman test, and you just need to modify package JSON. You need to use the TFM test script on the test. If you use, if you install it on plugin, don't forget the plugin flag. Also, you can give any arguments that Jest take as well. If you want coverage, just add publish coverage and use the TFM publish coverage script. You also can add global mocks under the file test setup in webpack folder. You can mock anything that you want to use globally. If you want to run the test, run any test, just run npm test on your terminal. So how to use it? Basically, I'm not going to show you, I'm not going to show a deep dive of it, just an example to show how simple it is. So this is, as you can see here, a unit test for a component. It's not a real component. It's just for to give you an example. We use a function from the Foreman test, which is for unit test. It's take a component, as you can see here in the function arguments. We give one, we give the component, and the second argument is the fixtures. So the fixtures object, each key on the fixtures object is the title, the test of the test titles, and any value is the props of the component we want to test. This test creates a snapshot automatically. So for more documentations and more examples, as Ron mentioned before, you can use our storybook, npm run storybook. And of course, you can see now our new storybook. And back to you, Avi.
Thank you, Amir. So this was very interesting. So now as a plugin developer, I can install the Foreman test and just run test easily. So I will share my screen again. It's always so annoying. Okay, so I will be the next one talking about the Foreman stories. So what is the Foreman stories? The Foreman stories is a playground, a place you can demonstrate your component, you can see live how your component functioning, and it's also a tool to document your component. So let's see how it works. So if I'm going to Foreman.js, now we have the Foreman stories package here. And you can see all the documentation if you want to install the Foreman stories in your plugin and if you want to use it. And it's basically pretty easy, just npm install this package. So if you want to write a story, first of all, you need to have a component. So for example, here I'm having this component. And in order to write a story for this component, I will just create a new file next to my component. And I will use the .stories.js extension. So the Foreman stories will know it's a story file and it will know how to compile it for me and use it in my storybook. And to write a story, it's pretty simple. In your story.js, in your .stories.js file, you need a default export with a title, the title of your story, with the component that you want to write a story to, and then each named export will be a story compiled into the storybook. Another cool thing that you will get with the storybook
is documenting around your component. So if I have a batch component and I have a description on the batch component, this is a JS doc style description, the storybook engine will automatically take it and compile it to your storybook as the description of the component. Same for prop types. The new storybook will know how to recognize your component prop types and show a table with all the prop types. And above the prop types, you can use a JS comment and name and give a description. And then the storybook engine will know how to take it and use it as the description of the prop type. Let's see it live. So in order to use that, this is Foreman Tasks, a plugin that many of you don't know. So first of all, I installed the Foreman Stories in my project. And second, I had to create this script, TFM Stories -- plugin. And now if I will run the stories command, it will search for .stories file, and it will compile them into a storybook so I can use it as a playground, as a documentation tool, and I can work with my component and test them. So this is the storybook. At the left side, I will have my components list, my tree. So for example, let's look at some stories. I have in the chart stories, tasks donut chart, which is a component. And here I see the chart rendered. I can play with the chart. I can click on the chart and I can see actions on the bottom left side. And I can interact it with nodes. So for example, if I want to change the value from 3 to 4, I can change it from here and my component will get re-rendered. I can also change, for example, the focus. Let's say set the focus on total, and now total is focused. If I will go to the docs at the top left side, now I will see the component here. I can look at the prop types table and see all the props that my component will receive and with some description about them. I can also click on show code and see the code of the component. So this code will render this result. Now I can use that and use it in my code. So I can see it as a documentation tool. So I have a docs and I have Canvas, which is a playground, and docs, which are documentations. Another thing that I can do with the Foreman stories is writing stories in a different format. So if I will look at this story, you can see it's basically a JavaScript file with a component that I'm exporting. Now, I can do something different and I can use MDX syntax. MDX is markdown on steroids. It's like markdown and JSX together. So I can write markdown and JavaScript and HTML in the same file. Let's see how it looks like. Let's call it my story.stories.mdx. So I will use the MDX extension now. So if we look at the documentation of the storybook, we can see here the example of how to write an MDX storybook. So first of all, I will copy this area. So first, I will import the meta component from the Foreman stories. I will give it a title let's say I will call it my new component, my new story. And I don't have to give a component. I will save it and let's run the stories again. And by the way, one thing I forgot to mention, the storybook has a live reload. So once I will save my code, it should automatically update the view with the new changes in my component. And as you can see, I have here, this is my story, just like I created an MD file. But I say that it's markdown on steroids, yeah? So let's try to use something which is more complicated, yeah? So for example, I can render a button here if I want. And I have an HTML button here. I can also render a component. Of course, I can import any component and just render it. And there are also some cool things like a preview component, which I can put some things in a preview component. And now I will have it in a preview. And I can also wrap it in a story component, and then it will be an actual story. Something went wrong. Maybe I did something which I shouldn't do. And another thing that I can do, I can render a props table. I can use the props component and give it a component. So for example, if I had a button component, I can just put a button here and it would render the button prop types. So this way I can write much better documentations with live example, and basically the sky is the limit. So we build a new code, and now we are waiting for developers to use this tool and create new cool things. So that's it. That was the demo about the Foreman stories. So I hope you are all enjoyed today. If you have any question about anything you see today, we are available at the IRC in the Freenode channel the Foreman. We will also available in Twitter and in YouTube. And in Discourse, community.foreman.org. See you, take care. Thank you for watching.